Alright, so our company. I'm from Slovakia.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Startup as well.
Yeah.
Does it generate revenue?
Yeah, we do, of course.
How?
And what? You pay for events.
Okay. So this room is for
booking. So you guys.
Right, can you pass that to me?
Would you?
You want to see
if
it's going to be out of sync. The only
sure.
way to find out
is
for me to...
Sitting up the audio, yeah?
But who, like, just to talk to the mic, right?
No, no, I can do it, it's fine. So we are technically streaming. Let me just double check that all that's going. That's fine. I'm on shot. There we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Testing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. One, two, two, one, two. One, two, two, one, two, one, two, three, one, two, two, one, two. Just need to have a look at that audio meter. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2. 1-2, 1-2.
Right. Good evening, everyone. If everybody would just like to find a seat, I think we're ready to begin. Right. Good evening. My name's Nick Badman. I run the Centre for Entrepreneurship here at CAS, and it's my very great privilege tonight to welcome you all to CAS Business School in the heart of the City of London. For those of you who don't know CAS or know CAS less well, we have three campuses here in the city and one over in Dubai. We have around about 4,000 students who are enrolled for a whole variety of courses and programs around business and finance. 1,400 of those people are involved in MSc programs in finance, insurance, shipping, real estate, and a whole variety of very diverse and practical and important subjects. We also have over 450 MBA students and 100 doctoral students. For those who have less time, less appetite for full-time education, we're also running a burgeoning collection of shorter programmes, ranging from this summer, a programme on strategic leadership in action in conjunction with the Royal Military Academy at Sandhurst, a programme on leading digital transformation, another one in finance for non-financed leaders, and a summer school for those who want to sample a variety of modules from our various programmes. Now, being a business school, we're also very research active, and in the recent research excellence framework, 84% of the research generated by the academics here was rated either world leading or internationally excellent, which was a great result for CAS and puts us very firmly in the upper echelons of UK business schools. So that's kind of what we do as a more academic institution, but we're here tonight for something a little bit different, to learn about and to celebrate success in the field of entrepreneurship. And it's going to be my pleasure to welcome our friends and partners, Startup Grind, who are running tonight's event, and of course our guest speaker tonight, David Buttress. Now, any business school will say that entrepreneurship and the building and scaling of successful businesses is close to their hearts. And CAS certainly says that. But at CAS, that activity is both close to our hearts and, rather unusually for a business school, very close to our wallets as well. We're a little bit unusual amongst leading business schools in that in the field of entrepreneurship, we eat our own cooking. So when we find amongst our community of students and alums and associates promising entrepreneurs and promising business ideas, we have here a fund that actually invests hard cash in them, up to £500,000 a time. And over the last 4 years, we've built a really exciting portfolio of young businesses that literally have CAS and CAS money inside them. And those businesses do a whole range of things, ranging from reputation analytics through cloud computing through to running wine events here in the city. That experience has gone reasonably well for us, and we're actually close to making our first realizations from from our first fund. So as a result, hopefully there will be a second fund in due course. And this will be an activity that gets thoroughly embedded in the DNA at CAS. However, one regret personally that I have is that sadly, there was one company we weren't invested in. Its name is Just Eat. But I'm dying to hear more about it, more about the people behind it, how it grew to the great success story that it is. And so it's my great pleasure now to hand over to Marion, who's going to be running this evening and letting us learn all about it.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Hi. Good evening. Really briefly, Startup Grind, you might know. Does anybody here is here for the first time and never heard about Startup Grind? A few people, okay. Startup Grind is a community of entrepreneurs. So we are excited to help every entrepreneur on the planet. When we were starting here in London, 14 months ago, we were based in 70 cities around the world. Now, today we are in 160 of them. We doubled in last year, and we aim to have 500 cities in the next 18 months. So we are in cities like, we are in three cities in Iran, we are all over Africa, South America, Asia, in those places where entrepreneurship is really needed because we help build the ecosystem. And we do it by events like these on a monthly basis. We get somebody really inspirational to share the journey with us. We had a big conference 2 weeks ago in Silicon Valley with founders of Twitter and Instagram and Airbnb. We learned a lot, and we want to keep continuing to learn from journeys of our speakers. And the speaker tonight is a company which is in the food industry. It's not the first one, because we had, as you can remember, Zomato in July. So Just Eat is a company which went public, you might know, last year. They raised $1.5 billion on LSE. It was the biggest tech IPO in the last 8 years. And our guest speaker tonight, he joined the company in 2006 to become a country manager. And he was the co-founder of the UK branch. And in 2013, he became the group CEO. And you can follow and see Just Eat everywhere. So without any further ado, please get on your feet and welcome David Butters.
Thank you.
So David, thank you so much for coming. We are really honored.
My pleasure.
Because Just Eat is one of the companies which really is rock and rolling in the UK. And
yeah.
You want to see more of companies like yours. Can you just tell us where does your entrepreneurial journey start?
I think for me, my entrepreneurial journey started when I was pretty young. Actually, when I was 10, 11 years old. I like lots of kids, getting paper rounds, trying to get pocket money, and I lived in a pretty poor neighbourhood. So I had to get some money. So I was going to get a paper round, and I realised actually doing a paper round, I was going to get £3 a week. I was working for this local news agent. And I thought to myself, wait, this guy, I'm going to deliver 70 papers, and each paper's 40 pence. Why would I do that for him? I can deliver the papers and buy the papers myself. So I went to the W.H. Smith wholesaler in Cardiff City Centre, and I got my dad to open an account with him, and I bought the newspapers myself. And then I went and knocked on doors in my neighbourhood where I lived and said, I'll deliver the papers, and I literally did that. And that was the first kind of thing where my dad was like, where's that come from? Where'd you get that from? And instead of earning £3 a week, I earned £10 a week, which at the time in the 1980s was a lot when you're 12 years old. So I think for me, it was something that was just within me. And then by the time I started university, I knew I always wanted to sort of at some point start my own business.
Interesting. Before we go any further, so you probably know the Slido technology we're using. So basically, you can go on slido.com and use the hashtag SGL and ask any questions you want. We are going to be jumping into the questions and answering them. You can vote to the questions you like, so the best questions will be answered. And the hashtag is Startup Grind if you want to use Twitter for us. David, with After you finished university, you went to work for a company straight away, or what happened afterwards?
So I went to work for Coca-Cola, and
so we have product placement here.
Yeah, we have product placement. So I'm still loyal. Loyalty is an important quality. I finished college and I did a law and business degree and I didn't enjoy actually my degree particularly, but you know, I got lots of good things from it, but I didn't particularly. I knew I didn't want to be a lawyer for sure not. So I thought I want to get into business and applied for various graduate training schemes and I joined Coke, and I'm glad I did. It was great for me personally. It was a huge organisation, obviously. But the one thing I think, if I look back on that time at Coke, that I got was a ton of great learning and experience, because what Coke had was a fantastic training programme for graduates. And I think I just sucked the life out of that. I literally signed up for every course, did loads of different stuff. And I think when I look back on that even now, there's still stuff that I learned between 21 and 26 in those sort of formative years when you first start your career, mm-hmm. that I actually still use. There's still some good fundamental business skills.
Right?
Yeah, of course. Absolutely, yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And did the program went around the company, or was it just focused on sales within Coke?
So I did several, but ended up focusing predominantly on sales and then leading. And then how I ended in Just Eat actually was my penultimate role in Coke was leading the restaurant sector strategy here in the UK and Ireland.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And so I got really interested in the restaurant space. Met a lot of great entrepreneurs who were starting restaurant businesses at the time. It was early days of Nando's actually. I met Robbie Entwistle when they were kicking Nando's off. And really sort of invigorated my interest in two things. One was getting back to, I want to start my own business. And second of all, I was interested in the restaurant space.
Are there any tips which you use to make sure the restaurants are using Coke and not Pepsi?
Yeah, I think you have to go back to, and I think this is something I've always had at Just Eat actually. Even at day one at Just Eat, we never gave the product away for free. I don't believe in it. Maybe it's part of my DNA from Coke, but I believe in value selling. So when you're at Coca-Cola, when you walk into Nando's, in the end it's brown sugared water, right? It's brown sugared water, one's blue and one's red. So when you walk into a Nando's, Pepsi will always say, we'll sell you £13 for a 10 litre bag in box. Mm-hmm. And Coke will say, that same 10 litre bag in box is £17. Now if you're a purchasing director, that's a pretty big difference. And in the end, it's just brown sugared water. But what I think Coke taught all their sales teams brilliantly was actually to value sell. So what does that mean? It's about brand perception. It's about consumer, how they feel about the product.
I agree.
Quality of the vessel, the quality of the serve. And if you can do that, you can charge more. And if you can do all that stuff well, you can definitely command a premium. And as a result, your brand actually perceived by consumers is always higher. So I think that was something for me at Just Eat. Even in day one, we never gave the product away. We were always going to sell it for a price and people should pay.
Oh, interesting. And you were doing the restaurant industry within Coke?
Yes. So
and how did you hear about Just Eat? Did it come over from Denmark, right?
Yeah, so it was an interesting one because I think to some extent you sort of create your own destiny. I won't go too far with that, but I think you do create to some extent your own destiny. And what happened was I was looking around for businesses. I was looking around for business in the restaurant space. And a colleague of mine in Copenhagen in the Coke system, which is at Carlsberg actually in Denmark, called me up and said, oh, there's this guy who started Just Eat in Denmark. He's a really interesting, fun entrepreneur. But you know, if you could do me a favor, it's not really worth your time. But if you could just buy him lunch, he's coming to London, I'm trying to win his business in Denmark, and I'll owe you one. And the easiest thing in the world for me to have said at the time was, no, I don't want to do it, I'm busy, he made an excuse, whatever. Yeah. And I didn't, and I said, absolutely, I'll do that for you, and I took him for lunch at Nando's. that's actually true. And we got talking, and we became friends, actually, and I was telling about my ideas, and I want to start a business, and by the second or third meeting, and I introduced him to some restaurant contacts here in the UK as a favour, and then by the second or third meeting, he said, listen, have you ever thought of doing Just Eat in the UK? And I said to him, you must be mad, you know, because he was a bit of a spivvy entrepreneur at the time, to be fair. So I said, no, you must be mad. But the more I looked into it, the more I thought, actually, the dynamics of the UK market are crying out for this. And mm-hmm. if we don't do it, someone will. Why not be us, I guess?
Okay, so you actually did a favor to Guy and got a job. And what a job, right?
Yeah, I should say thank you to him, actually.
Yeah. Wow. And then you decided, okay, let's do this. How did you start from scratch?
Yeah, it was, I think you get quite idealistic about starting a business, which is a good thing actually, because I think it's a bit like having a child. You'd actually never do it if you knew the reality. Mm. So I was very idealistic about it and was like so excited. I remember telling everyone, oh, I'm going to start this business, we're going to take over the world and all that stuff. And then of course day one, you arrive and there's nothing, right? There's no office, there's no computer, there's no desk, you know, it's not like a Coke where you ring and someone says, oh, I need a new computer, and then someone comes and sets it up. So we had nothing, and we also didn't have any cash, of course. The business was bootstrapped, so we literally lived hand to mouth, and every time we needed some fund, I wish the cash business fund was available to us at the time. You know, we were bootstrapped, and we just survived. I mean, the first month of just our revenues were £33, net revenues, and that was between two of us, right? So it's pretty depressing to go home. It's pretty depressing to go home at the end of the first month. And so I gave up my job, and I earned £16.50.
And you were expecting to earn your revenues how quickly? Next year, or what was the business plan?
We sort of gave ourselves a year, I think psychologically and financially. We sort of said, let's give it a year to give it a chance. But I think like all entrepreneurs, you get so irrational about your business. I think the year was probably would have gone out the window. We were all so committed to it. But we gave ourselves a year. But within the first year, we actually ran out of cash twice. So we actually nearly stopped in August 06.
Oh wow!
We were. It was really tough, and you know, I think.
How did you solve it?
I think that great human instinct of necessity being the mother of all invention. I think like starting businesses to some extent. If you, one of my favorite programs is that airplane investigation program on National Geographic, they always show when sort of planes crash. They
find a way.
Yeah, they often find a way. And one of the great analogies I think from those scenarios is you've put a pilot in a simulator. And they'll never be able to land a plane in the simulator given the set of circumstances that transpired in a potential air disaster. But interestingly, in that moment where they're actually in the air at 35,000 feet and there's a problem, they found a way to get the plane to the ground because the necessity, a bit like Apollo 13, I guess is the most famous story of that, right? They got Apollo 13 home. If you'd have given them 45 minutes to invent an oxygen system within 45 minutes, they never would have done it. If you said three astronauts are going to die in 45 minutes, they found a way. And I think businesses are a bit like that. You know, we run out of cash, and the easiest thing to have done would have stopped. I think none of our families would have said, you failed. You know, they all know how hard we'd worked, even to that point. But I go back to that point, necessity of invention. We just found a way. We brought a new pricing model. I think we did something like, I don't know how many angel investor meetings in about a 70-hour period. And then we met a guy in Spitalfields Market, an angel investor who wrote us a check, and we carried on. And that was probably without that moment, we probably would have been done. But thankfully, he did.
And you organized this at Just Eat UK, or he wrote the check for Just Eat
Group? Yeah, he did a great deal. Bastard. No, without him, you know, what do you have? You can have 100% of nothing, right? So, he did. I'm sure he would look back at it and say it was the deal of the century. He got in at a valuation of £2 million and took about 30% of the business. And
oh, wow.
So, yeah, he did okay.
And
so, when the company IPO'd at £1.3 billion, he looked pretty clever.
You said the UK market was crying out for something like Just Eat. What's the biggest point, biggest pain you want to solve with it?
I think the big thing for me was I was actually more restaurant led, as I said, than more consumer led. The big thing that I saw was that there's this huge fragmented supply side, right? So you had all these independent, and I love the restaurant in our industry, right? They are brilliant entrepreneurs. They work bloody hard, right? There's a reason why there's a great takeaway culture and the reason why we all love curry. Mm-hmm. It's because actually entrepreneurs that run those places in our communities are bloody good entrepreneurs and make great food and they care. So I could see that there was this fragmented supply side. You could see these chains beginning to come into the market and these guys were going to get marginalized over time by technology. It was obvious. The reason why you only have to look at North America and the chain network system you have in North America in the restaurant sector. Well, the reason you have that is of course, chains over the last decade in particular have been able to exploit all the digitalization of consumers. Because if you're Domino's, you can build a great mobile product, a great website product, great back-end system, consumers trust your brand, they pay online, etc. Mm-hmm. Well, if you're a local pizzeria that makes better pizza than Domino's, you can do that. You definitely can compete on PPC sure. with world-class tools and everything else. So you just get marginalized over time. So I think for me, the origins for me were you have a load of great restaurateurs and we wanted to partner with them. Mm-hmm. Actually, so that I was focused more on what we were fixing on the restaurant side to give all these independents a great, hopefully, digital product that enabled them to compete with chains. Ironically, I think the big benefit we created as a result was the consumer benefit. Because, of course, you took all this information and put it in one place and were enabling consumers then to connect to every choice in their neighborhood, which is actually far more compelling. But okay. So there was both sides to it. But in my original thinking, I was more focused on the restaurant side. But that's changed over the last 5-6 years.
So you build the website, you build the tools. And how did you get the customers to use it?
Yeah, as I said, we didn't have any money, so we were bootstrapped. So we did two things. We put stickers in every restaurant window, Because it doesn't cost anything.
It's very smart.
I physically did that for the first 18 months.
Stickers with the website? Or?
Yeah, I even put them in the back of my wife's car, which she's, I don't think she's ever going to forgive me for. She never lets me forget that. But so I used to have these stickers in my bag, and I would literally brand up the restaurant windows. And go back to your learnings, right? When my first job at Coke, the first thing Coke make you do as a graduate trainee, I think they knock a few of the cockiness off you. They sent you branding in independent retailers, news agents. So you had to put up the Coke branding you see around restaurant news agent windows.
Yeah.
I did that for the first couple of weeks, and everyone has to do that when you join Coke, whatever your job is. So I sort of had that instinct anyway, and I knew it worked, right? If you have 30 stickers on a consumer's journey home from a tube station, in those, and let's remember, a lot of our restaurants are in prime high street locations, right? If I run Clear Channel and said, I want 30 posters in windows from Putney Station to Fulham. Mm-hmm. It's a no problem, that's 50 grand for the next 8 weeks. Well, actually, I can do that by getting off my backside, getting a sticker and going into 20 restaurants and saying, hey, listen, can I please put a sticker there? Looks like this, thank you very much. And they say yes. And as a result, that local activation piece started to stimulate some consumer orders in those communities. And the other side to that, of course, was digital. So the one other thing we had, every penny we had, literally every penny we had, we spent on PPC marketing. Because, okay, of course, what we always wanted to do is make sure we grabbed any online demand searching for takeaway. Well, it's completely logical you grab that.
That's fine. And what's the sequence? Because we have a bunch of entrepreneurs here building their startups. Just to understand the right order of these things. So you first, did you go to a restaurant which never heard about Just Eat and ask them to put a sticker on the
window? Yeah, so what I did was I used to go to the office every morning at 7:30 a.m. I used to work in the office at 11 a.m. And then at 11 a.m. I'd go on the road until between 8 and 9 p.m. But my rule, the reason why I say between 8 and 9 p.m., I would never go home until I'd actually recruited at least one restaurant onto our network every day. So, go back to necessity and the mother of invention, you find a way to get one at 8 p.m.
What was the ratio of the ones you talked to and the ones you
went with? 12, 6, and 1. So I used to visit 12 restaurants in a day, do 6 presentations, and one would sign. And that was the first days of Just Eat ratio. Now, our sales guys always tell me it's hard, and we get 500 inbound leads a month from restaurants asking us to join. So I sort of sit there and try not to, strangle them. But, so it was 12, 6, and 1.
Interesting.
And that evolved over time as people got brand aware about that concept.
And you offer the sticker right at the beginning when you convert them, when they say yes?
Always. That and some little vouchers that used to say 10% off if you order on Just Eat. Otherwise, okay, but ask them,
just
please,
to kickstart the,
please put
the
that. And I think always good to be humble. I was really honest with the restaurant, say, listen, we're a startup. We're working really hard to try, so anything you can do to help. And it's amazing, actually, if you ask people to help, how many people will say yes. Loads of our restaurants, and I think it's important, and I hope, and I certainly in my time, Just Eat should never forget that. Those many restaurateurs massively helped us and agreed to put vouchers in their pizza boxes. Why? Why did they do that? They're helping to build our business. They just did it because they were good people and wanted to help us. And the sticker in the window piece now, I think, acts as a real stamp of credibility for a takeaway restaurant. But in the early days, it didn't. It again was for our benefit. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
And did you find all of them were equally excited about it? There were some which were not. How did you motivate those ones which were not?
Yeah, so the first, actually this is a true story, the first restaurant I ever went in was in Commercial Road in Canary Wharf. It's called Speedo Pizza. It's still on Just Eat, actually. And he threw me out because he thought I was the VAT man. Because it was, I was in a suit. Uh-huh. And it's not really a smart thing to do in our industry to wear a suit. I haven't worn a suit since, it's more casual.
Okay.
So the way I dealt with it was to remember that a no today is just a no today, right? It's not a no tomorrow. So what I would do is, if I go back to that, if you take E14, which is Docklands in obviously East London, there's around 130 takeaway restaurants in that postcode. And of course, I've visited those personally probably 1,000 times to sign about 50 of them. And then we now have all 130, but they've probably been visited, each of them has probably visited 10 to 20 times over an 8-year, 9-year period. And the last one obviously only said yes, so maybe a month ago. So it's about understanding no is no today, it's not no tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But it's also remembering this, you can't just go back tomorrow and harass someone. It's remembering that you can probably go back in 3-4 months with a different message or an explanation of why. And of course, my different new message would always be, this is how much Just Eat has grown since the last time we spoke. And of course, that's a good thing to hear, right? Because if you're trying to grow your business, you want to work with people who are growing and are going to help bring you new customers. And for a restaurant, that became very compelling data. And I would never show them leads data if I was in Manchester. I'd show them, this is Leeds, and this is Headingley, and this is your street. because local data is far more powerful than me telling some guy in Leeds that we're big in London has no relevance whatsoever. He cares about how big we are in his area. So getting that local data became very powerful, convincing restaurants we were a good partner to work with.
The industry is obviously very competitive. Did you try to use data against them? For example, the competitor across the street, they're already on Just Eat doing well. Or this wouldn't work?
No, I've had sort of my own. My philosophy on competition is this, right? Remember what the big competitor is, not what the person is next to you doing the same thing. The big competitor in my industry is the telephone. My big competitor is not Hungry House or Domino's or in a different market, it would be a different brand. My big competitor is the telephone. 7 out of 10 consumers in the UK still use the phone. So I think I think lots of entrepreneurs make the mistake of getting quite colloquial about the competition. And again, a little bit sort of narrow-minded, think, oh, these guys are doing the same as us, they're the competitor. No, your competitor is whatever the consumer is currently doing that you want them to do that they're not doing. In our industry, that's telephone ordering. Mm-hmm. My competitor is the phone, and I want to get consumers to stop using the phone and move to digital and move online. And if I do that, hopefully I build the best product, have the best execution, and they use my product, not another. But I used, I always had that philosophy as a starting point. And then I think your reputation and the data will speak for itself, because you're right. When you're talking to the industry then about your data, go back to the Coke analogy versus Pepsi, you should never talk bad about the competitor, right? That's such a lousy behaviour, right? And lousy behaviour. But what you can do is talk about the positives on your performance and what you're doing. And I think as you get network effects, which we do in our business, as we grow, we become more successful, that's what you talk about.
Mm-hmm. And when you were starting, you said you were converting local areas. How did you expand from that?
So We had the old university cities was our starting point. So we did the top 10 old university towns of the UK first. And that took us about 12 months. And once we had traction in those areas, then we'd go to the next city, and the next city, and the next city. And the way we did it, you won't believe it, but it was so unscientific, I'm not too embarrassed to admit it, we based it off population. So we had no idea of demographics. We had no idea of consumer demand. We just went, where are the most people? Where are they most dense? So we'll go there. It kind of worked, but it wasn't the most sophisticated. Then over time, we realized that things like how much takeaway they eat, how many restaurants are there, is also quite an important thing to understand. But that took us 3 years. We weren't that smart.
Now we know, yeah. Okay, we have a nice question on Slido. This one from Bashar. What was the most difficult stage in Just Eat's life as a startup?
Without question for me was those times when we I remember going home having turned over 33 quid. That was pretty depressing because I just thought, wow. Because I think rightly, we always had a sense wherever we wanted to build, we wanted to build something that was going to be big. We always wanted to, it was never going to be a lifestyle business. This is about building something we hope to be a great company. We very naively said in the very early days, we want to build a company that our grandkids say, wow, our grandparents built that. And that was like kind of a very lofty ambition or vision, but we did have that. So I remember thinking when we went on with 32.3 quid worth of revenue, thinking, is this just too niche-y? Is this going to be too small a business? Because we weren't first mover, right? We were third mover into the industry. So I thought maybe those guys haven't got traction because actually there's just the market's just too small for this. So that was kind of a test of sort of confidence, if you like. Mm-hmm. And you have people around you, you have people giving you loads of support, but you also have doubters. Yeah. My dad was a big doubter, so my dad was like, why have you given up a proper job to do this? And then, of course, the cash moment was an incredibly difficult moment. That was probably the closest I came to thinking this is not going to. It could have gone either way, actually.
Yeah. You mentioned that when you were starting, you had expanded area by area, and then you put those stickers out, you went online to do PPC.
Yeah.
Did you see any traction there, or how did you know that people actually search for delivering online?
Yeah, that was a brilliant moment. Actually, I always remember this. We started. It was a great moment. We did our first proper PPC campaign. We had something like £1,000, which we put on a credit card, we put it in the Google account, and the demand was just incredible. That's when we knew, right? Now, what we didn't have was a massive mistake. We wasted £1,000 because we didn't have sufficient restaurant coverage. So, of course, what happened, people went to Just Eat and they put their location in and they bounced because, of course, if you've got just one pizza outlet in the area, but no Indian, no Chinese, no kebab, no Thai, no sushi, If you don't have anything and you only have one pizza outlet, well, as an aggregator or as a marketplace business model, you're useless, right? Because the consumer just says, well, what sort of product is this for me? I've come looking for restaurants in my area and you've got one. So we realized very quickly, my partner said to me, Dave, you better go and start more restaurants, which was helpful encouragement. So we realized that the one key metric, we needed three restaurants of every major cuisine category in an area before you ramp the PPC up. And up until then, we just left organic, click it through.
So what are the major categories you
were? So in the UK, it depends on the market. But if we talk the UK, the biggest category is Chinese, closely followed by Indian, then pizza. And then beneath that, there are some other smaller minority categories which are growing quickest, which is Thai and sushi. Mm-hmm.
One more question concerning the past of Just Eat. Just Eat relocated from Denmark to the UK. How did that happen?
It happened because the UK business became such a powerhouse for the group. The Danish team, obviously, we've done a business in Denmark. I think we have something like 90% market share in Denmark. We're a big Danish brand now by Danish standards for sure. But the reality is our Danish team, there's 40 odd employees in our Danish team, and we obviously employ 600-700 people a year in the UK. So it was just a product of, in 2009, we did our Series A round with Index Ventures. And when we closed our Series A round with Index, it was very obvious that the UK was even though at the time it wasn't the biggest from a revenue perspective part of the group, it was growing dramatically, like 300% year on year. So it was very obvious that the UK was going to become the central, the key strategic part of the business for the next 3-4 years. So it made sense at that point to build all the headquarters.
Do you know the concerns of Index, for example, during the negotiations of what they thought might not work?
I think the big thing for Index at the time, and they were dead right, was the product. Because we were so commercially focused on acquiring restaurants and acquiring consumers, I think we hadn't focused sufficiently well on the product side. And as a result, there was some really bad user experience around the product. So there were big question marks around that. And at the time, we didn't have a CTO. So our engineer was like one of the early guys. He was a great guy, super smart guy, but he wasn't an engineer by training. He wasn't a CTO to scale up a platform the way we were growing. So one of the things Index insisted on was you need guys to go and get a proper CTO. Alongside their investment and what they did, what Index were great for us, they made some unbelievable introductions to some brilliant CTOs.
Okay. And in terms of the biggest mistake at the beginning, so you said the BBC campaign went wrong because you didn't have the coverage. Now, having CTO really helps when scaling. Are there any other learnings you had when starting which you probably wouldn't do again?
Retain more equity. I'm not kidding. So I would say the big one for me is, and it's a tough one, right? But you've got to raise money as quick as possible, because I think a lot of entrepreneurs get stuck in, my business is growing and I don't want to dilute myself. And I think if we'd have been really smart at Just Eat, we would have done the IPO, we'd have done our Series A in 2007. Because I think we'd have been even still today 18 months further along from where we are. We just bootstrapped it for too long. It was with good intentions, right? But it was really, really naive. That capital from Index in 2009 completely transformed our company. We were able to do our first major TV campaign, hire a fantastic CTO. You hire great people, guess what happens? You grow even quicker. Mm-hmm. And it was a real sort of moment of, it was almost like embarrassment after when we look back on 2009 and the Index round, we think, why didn't we do that in 2007? So I think if you've got a great business and a great business model, it's growing quickly, but you're capital constrained, but you can see that you need capital to accelerate, then just get it done. Because I think so, we were talking earlier, talking about going from feast to famine. When those things are in place, you'll have people knocking on your door to give you capital, and you should take it.
Talking about funding, there's a question here from Slido, from James Roy Poulter. Deliveroo just raised 25 million and is rapidly gaining market share in the premium end of the market. You also share an investor direct on boards.
Yeah.
Is it not a conflict? Will you move into delivery?
Yeah, so it's not a conflict for me. Index is a venture capital company. They can back in all different verticals, so it's no problem for that. They, of course, check with us first, out of courtesy. I don't think so. I think you have to remember it. Go back to what I said about the competition, right? I think Just Eat's been incredibly successful focusing on our core business and doing our core business incredibly well. Now, we actually do Deliveroo in Copenhagen. We actually do the logistics. We have 50 cars in Copenhagen that do the delivery. Mm-hmm. And one of the challenges we've seen in that is the scaling up and the capital intensity of logistical business models. It's incredibly difficult. Yeah. and it's very different to the business we're trying to build. And I'm sure, you know, I've no doubt in the middle to high end, in certain pockets of niches within London and certain cities, there's a market for it. I'm not convinced the market is as big for that product as is for our core business. And you know, to give context, you know, we're processing literally millions and millions and millions of orders a month just in the UK. And businesses that are similar to that are doing in the sort of 5 to 10 to 15,000 mark. So I think you've got to keep context. I think the way we think about logistics is slightly different as well. The way we think about logistics, I don't want Just Eat to build a logistical arm to it. I want Just Eat to take the existing logistics in the delivery takeaway market and organize it better. And what does that mean? It means if you think about what Uber has done for the independent car drivers of the world, I think Just Eat can do that for the independent takeaway drivers of the world. As a technology company, I think that's incredibly exciting. On Saturday night in the UK, we'll have between 35 and 40,000 delivery drivers pinging around delivering takeaway, right? Mm-hmm. Now, they're not our drivers, they're the local restaurants. But bear in mind how closely integrated we're becoming with our restaurant partners. They're using our hardware and software to process their orders more and more. Why could we not create an app that's on the smartphone of a driver? In fact, we've already done it, and it's in 25 outlets, where the driver downloads the app and we track the driver on behalf of the restaurant and the consumer, and you can see where your takeaway food is from when it leaves the store to when it arrives at your front door.
Yeah.
Now, if we can do that, and we can, I believe, it has challenges, but it's incredibly exciting. If we can do that, I think that's how we think about addressing logistics in our space.
It's a very big mission. It's a big mission. Can you talk about numbers a little bit? So how many restaurants do you have in your network in the UK, for example?
So in the UK, we have 25 and just over 25,000 restaurants online on Just Eat of a total market of between 32 and 34,000 restaurants.
Do you consider the market penetrated already, or is it still a long way to go?
From a consumer side or from a restaurant side?
From restaurants.
I think the restaurant side will continue to recruit restaurants for another 18 months in the UK, and at that point we will have pretty or much all the delivery restaurants we need.
Yeah.
Important to note, we've only just started in collection. 12 months ago we started a pilot in the collection or pickup market, as if you're North American. And the collection market is another around 35,000 restaurants here in the UK. Now that's where more will overlap with Deliveroo, right? Because there, what they're doing is going to that. That is more the mid to high end that they're then doing the delivery for. So we're pushing into that market from an aggregating the collection market perspective. Let's see where it gets to from a logistics. I'm not sure.
Is this the same market as you currently serving, or it's totally different in terms of?
Collection's a completely new market for us. We've never addressed it. We've been 100% focused on delivery only up until about 12 months ago.
Mm-hmm. Because you mentioned the product was kind of a bit weaker at the beginning.
Yeah.
Is it something which you need a separate product for, or you can still deliver it within the existing?
No, box? We can deliver within the existing product. I think it just requires better search tools for consumers. But you know, we can address it, and we are addressing it within the existing product. It just needs to be better and presented well, and have a good search mechanism within the homepage.
Okay, we mentioned Delivery Hero. They sold 30% of Hungry House to Rocket Internet for half a billion. Does it make you nervous?
I think you have to think about it this way. Rocket Internet, of course, they do their investments in a certain way. We value businesses differently. We think about the long term and what's sustainable. And when you've seen Just Eat acquire businesses, and we've acquired businesses all over the world, including here in the UK, we're very disciplined around how we do that.
Yeah.
So I would go back to the point, does it make me nervous? Well, no, because Hungry House has been owned by well-funded competitors for 5-6 years. It was funded by Delivery Hero previously, which is a very well-funded business with huge private equity and venture capital backers. And now it's owned by another, or part-owned by another well-funded backed company. So no, I don't think so. And we have a fully funded business plan for our business, so definitely not. And I go back to this, you know, if you think about how you out execute, money is one part of it. Money is one part of it, and Just Eat, as I said, we can't be out executed there. And I believe we have the best team. And if you have the best people and the best team, then I'm confident that you continue to win. And the last bit is we have, I think, an unbelievable market position in the markets we operate in, which are highly defendable. So it definitely doesn't make me nervous, but competition, I think, always galvanizes the spirit a little bit, right?
Yeah.
Which is not a bad thing.
Do you see something in the competition which they do well, and does it inspire you? Or push
yeah,
you
those. I have to say, I think they do. I think, in particularly, the Delivery Hero guys, I think they've done a really nice job with some of the mobile products in the early days. I think we probably 2.5 years ago had to do a bit of catch up on that. Mm-hmm. So they probably benefit a little bit from being a younger company, because of course our platform was 10 years old and theirs is 4 years old. But yeah, that was something that as I say, go back to galvanizing the spirit. It's good to have that. Think, right, come on, we've got to up our game, right?
Yeah.
So yeah.
We talked about acquisition. You recently bought a company in Mexico.
That's right.
So well done. Why is that?
So when we IPO'd the company, and the way Just Eat thinks about the world is we want to do two things. One, we want to get into build businesses in markets of scale. So, you know, we're not interested in going to small markets. We want to build big businesses in markets of scale. So Mexico ticks that box, right? It's a huge market. It's the second biggest takeaway market in Latin America after Brazil, and we're the market leader in Brazil.
Uh-huh.
So it's consistent with our strategy of that. If you combine Mexico and Brazil, they're around 90% of the whole LATAM market for takeaway.
Wow.
So it made a ton of sense there. And the second thing that we look at when we're going to acquire a business is, does it have clear market leadership in that market of scale? And as you probably read, the business we bought is the market leader in Mexico. So it fitted both criteria. It made sense for us. It was consistent with our strategy in LATAM. So yeah, that's
one. In terms of expanding into other regions globally, like you mentioned Latin America, what are the other ones which you still look out for?
So there's a few markets in the world that meet that criteria of being in markets of scale with a leader in market of scale. Of course, the elephant in the room is the US. But as you may or may not know, there is a big company in the US called Grubhub, which is also public in our sector. They went out one day after us, actually.
Yeah.
They did their IPO one day after we IPO'd. Mm-hmm. So they're there. There are some other markets, but I think all the big markets now have a player in them. I don't think there's no greenfield left in the industry, you can say. You couldn't go and start a Just Eat equivalent in wherever it might be in the world.
Yeah.
They're all there. Some markets are early stage, though, so some markets there's still opportunities. So you know, Just Eat, if the right asset in the right market in a market of scale was available at the right price, we'll have a good look at it.
Okay.
We don't necessarily have to do it.
Does it mean the US is not on your plate yet?
So no, we're not going to be going to the US. You won't see Just Eat in the US. We had a serious think about the US 4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah.
I think for the absolute right reasons we didn't go in the US, i.e. we're focused on our core businesses. We operate in 13 countries.
Mm-hmm.
And our business model is such that you're far better being clear market leader in the markets you operate in, and we have £20 billion worth of delivery food addressable to us in those 13 markets. We have a ton to shoot for. You're better off being really disciplined and winning huge in those 13 markets than going on some vanity project and saying, oh, we're in 49 countries, of which you're leader in none or even one, and badly executed. This is all about...
It makes sense. Funny enough, we had a discussion like this 6 months ago here with this company called Zomato.
Yeah.
And they actually, the answer was somehow similar, and they bought a company called Urban Spoon in the US.
Yeah.
A couple months ago. And we actually are honored because the back then UK country manager just moved up to become the COO. And now they're raising, I think, $1 billion valuation. Kimberly is here in the room, so welcome. We are happy to have you here. So we have had this discussion with Zomato about the US market and going there. So hopefully one day we're going to see Just Eat expanding everywhere, including the US.
Yeah, no, I think you won't see us go into that market. But I think the thing about, you know, Zomato, they're being more disruptive, I think, about how they think about the world. And the guys in Zomato have obviously done a brilliant job. If you look at their product, it's fantastic. They're also now, I think, believe in Italy as well. So
yeah. Totally. Now, the company here in the UK, when you see the operations in the UK and the international operations, you mentioned that the verticals of the food types are different. What else is different about the markets you are in?
So the big things that vary is obviously the food categories and the consumer preferences within it, and also, of course, the restaurant structure. So what do I mean by that? I mean the number of independents versus franchises. So, for example, our Canadian business, there's a lot more chains in North America, just full stop. Obviously, the US has huge chains, but Canada has more mid-sized chains than the huge states chains you see in the United States. But nevertheless, that absolutely does two things. One, it erodes the power of a marketplace, because remember, if you're a mid to large-sized chain, like, say, a Domino's here in the UK, you can build your own e-commerce tools.
Yeah.
And operate them at scale. And the second thing it does is, of course, it makes it more competitive to buy customers, i.e. CPA costs on Google go up because you're competing with maybe 10 different pizza chains for a pizza customer, as just a general analogy, which drives up. The winner there, of course, is Google. But they're your friend, it's fine. That's the dynamic that I see varying, is the number of independents in the market and also the number of chains.
In terms of the potential future developments, what is the vision? Like, where are you compared to where you wanted to be?
Yeah, okay. So the thing that excites me about Just Eat is I think we actually think of ourselves still as a startup, right? And I think that's a brilliant way to think about your business, because I just think there's so much more we can do, right? There's two kind of big things we want to address. The one thing I definitely want to address in the next few years, I want to be able to show you the biggest thing that we think about is what does the consumer tell us are the things they're trying us to want us to fix. And the first thing the consumer tells is, I don't know where my food is, and I don't know if it's going to come on time hot. So if that's the biggest thing the consumers tell us about the experience in our industry, let's fix that for them. And I think, go back to what I spoke about tracking earlier, why I think that's so important. If you fix that for a consumer, why do you ever order on the phone? If you can order on Just Eat and go into the app and see where your food is on its way to you, it's 5 minutes away, he's coming up your street, open your front door, there he is, bang, done. If we can do that, that's a real better consumer experience we create in the industry. I think on the other side of it, I love to think about, we'll know when you're hungry before you will, right? Because we're all so predictable as consumers. You know, when you order the first time on a Tuesday at 7 p.m. on Just Eat, if that's your first time you order at a Thai, we know that you'll come back every Tuesday at 7 p.m. and order the same Thai, and guess what, you order the same Tom Yum soup. You do, right? You do. You think you vary it, but you don't. And we can see that in the data.
That's interesting.
So if we can see that in the data, wow. Why for we as a brand cannot come to you on 5:30 on a Tuesday and say, hey, listen, we know it's Tuesday. We know you're going to order from this Thai restaurant at 7 p.m. Push that button, it'll be with you at 7. And I think that's the kind of consumer experience I'd love for Just Eat to be addressing.
Campaigns, so Tuesdays for those guys?
I think it's about using that data in a smart way that's not intrusive and is actually making someone's life a bit easier, right? And I think that's why, you know, you see our brand campaigns about mini fist pump. And the reason why it's about that is I think, you know, let's be frank, we're not changing people's lives, but we can make your life a bit better and have some fun with it. And I think that's where I think Just Eat plays nicely as a brand within the markets it operates in.
Okay, so you have some kind of predictive analytics team which is preparing some...
Yeah, so we can see, yeah, exactly. So our cohorts are incredibly stable. We can see once you get you to, for example, the third order, you never go back to the phone. So one of the big things is for our experienced team and getting you guys and getting our customers to do is get to this third order. If we get the third order, then we can see you become a digital consumer.
Once you start using Uber or Halo, it's really hard to go back to calling some
correct.
Other companies.
Yeah, correct. You just start. It just becomes part of your routine.
Yeah, that's right. So your product is kind of addictive, in a good way.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, from a product experience perspective. Yeah, I mean your habits. So if you order, you know, a curry every Friday night, and which is my habit, then, you know, you that's just your habit. I don't think Just Eat changes that fundamentally. I think, you know, you do what you do. You know, your lifestyle is your lifestyle. I don't think we're changing lifestyle. I think what we're doing is maybe changing the way you do it and hopefully making it a bit better.
Mm-hmm. So the milestone is just to get used to the customers and do what they want and predict what they want to do. One of the milestones of Just Eat was the big IPO. How tough was it to decide whether to do it or not?
I think for us it became super compelling because we were, if you look like the criteria, if you like, to be an IPO company, well, first of all, you need a certain scale, and at the time we had around £100 million of revenues, and so we had the scale to become a public company, which kind of made sense. We were high growth, we were growing at a significant rate, so we were still high growth, and we will be for many years, but we're still high growth. That was the other criteria. And the last thing we wanted to do is we wanted to be the access to capital, because as you've rightly pointed out, that it's not a quiet industry. There's lots happening all the time, and having that access to capital is really advantageous for us strategically. So if there is an asset in Mexico we think we want to acquire because it's a great local business, having that access to capital as a public company is incredibly, it's a good competitive advantage. Mm-hmm. So it made a ton of sense from that perspective.
So why not do a Series A or Series D?
We've done a Series A, B and C before we IPO'd. So over the years, we've done three different funding rounds. I think two things have happened. Those things I just described were the big three things. And the second thing, of course, we did have, you know, we had shareholders who've been in the business, angel investors for nearly a decade. Even though we call ourselves a startup, we're more than a decade old. Mm-hmm. A VC that had been in for 7 years at the time, and of course over the next 5 years they want to of course realize their returns, and you can only do that if you're on the market with a proven track record, so they can get out over time in an orderly way, if you like. Mm-hmm. So that was another reason for the rationale for the IPO.
That's interesting. Now, you mentioned when you raised the funding from Index you had a chance to get a great CTO.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about hiring and staff. How happy are you with when you're hiring people, that you get quality people? How tough is it to get really good talent on board?
Well, it's actually tough to get into Just Eat. We have really high criteria to get into the company. We want the best. Our demand is we want the best people in any market. We're extremely focused on that. It's getting harder, I think, to get really top talented people, especially in engineering, frankly. London's getting a tough place to get great engineers now. Although fortunately we're one of the employees great engineers want to work for, so it's not so bad for us. But it's changing. We've just opened a engineering office in Bristol, linked to Bristol University, because it's one of the UK's leading engineering universities, in order to allay that for the next few years and make sure we have top engineering talent keep coming into the company. But I think, you know, you have to do two things as an employer with that. One is I think you've got to stay true to your culture, and I think Just Eat's still a fun place to work and an informal place to work. We don't take ourselves too seriously. You know, we want to make it so people want to join this kind of high growth, exciting startup environment. So I think we've retained our cultural piece around that, and there's lots of things we do. We spend a lot of time as a leadership team making sure the company still feels like that and is like that in reality. I think the second thing you have to do, you have to accept that to get talented people, you've got to pay. There's no easy way around that. You have to be willing to pay. So I think Just Eat for the top talent is we're willing to pay for the top talent.
To keep the startup culture, how do you make sure you have the intrapreneurs in the company? How do you look out for them? How do you encourage them to come up with ideas?
Yeah, we do a few things actually. So obviously myself being one of the founders of the UK operation, you know, I'm obviously leading the company, so something I care about passionately. But the but it goes throughout the organization. We have local country managers in every market that are responsible for building those countries from an operational perspective locally. And of the 13 country managers we have, I think five of them are in effect founders. So they have a real strong entrepreneurial sense anyway, because they literally are the founders help or co-founders in that market with us. So they've helped us to build and execute locally. And I think culture is not complicated, actually. I think there's lots of books written about it which overcomplicate it. Culture is the leadership behavior of the people running the company. That's the company's culture. That's it. And it's how you behave every day. So you better be sure that the culture you're creating is one that is authentic to you and true to yourself, and it's one that you behave like every day. Because there's no saying we want this culture in Just Eat, but if the leadership team, say that, you know, the 25, 30 people running the company in our case now, don't behave like it and it's not true, that's not the company's culture. There'll be another culture. You might not like it, but there will be. So I think the one thing we've always tried to do is be true to ourselves and be true to the culture that we as a leadership team believe is the way we behave every day.
That's really interesting. Now, in terms of hiring people, and now you mentioned you have some programs in universities, that's very smart. How many engineers do you have in the company?
Over 200 now. Over 200. We have so the head HQ for engineering is actually here in London on Holborn Viaduct. Oh, now Amazon there, they call it Silicon Viaduct. On the Viaduct, and then we have this office in Bristol, and then we also have an office in Ukraine in Kiev.
To do the engineering?
Yeah, we have three offices. So the Kiev office does a lot of the international stuff. Mm-hmm. The UK office engineers all done from London. So, and of more than 100 odd engineers are actually here in London. And then there's about 30 now in Bristol.
Mm-hmm. And when you scale operations globally, how many offices do you think you need to conquer the world?
It's two parts. I think we need one headquarters, I think. But we need, in every market, we need a local operational office. The inherent local nature of our company, the inherent local nature of our execution means in any given market, we need local teams. Mm. That's boots on the ground from a sales perspective. That's local marketing, trade marketing. I spoke to a little bit about that earlier. Often it's call center, because we want to make sure the consumer when they order, we take care of the experience if it goes wrong. Okay. So we'll often have a call in every market right now. There's a call center. Mm-hmm. So there's an office in every market. And I think that helps to do two things. One, it helps us to understand the local cultural dynamics of that local market and be really close to it. And second of all, it means that we make damn sure that all those little inches I spoke about earlier from a local execution perspective, stickers in windows, all that stuff we know moves the needle over time, is being done and being done properly. You can't do that sat in London, which is why, you know, you couldn't sit in Mountain View in California, push a button and penetrate the world in our business model. You literally have to have boots on the ground.
That's true. And do you control that? Like, do you have any KPIs for how many stickers do you want to have in restaurants? And
Yep, we do. I'm a big believer in one of the maxims I got from my first boss was what guest measure gets done. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, it's important to measure everything. So one of the guys, one of the smartest guys in Just Eat is a guy called Adam Wright, who we got out of Expedia, who's head of our data analytics. So there's, yeah, we have a report for everything. We use Salesforce.com for our local sales teams. So all our local sales teams using Salesforce.com to measure and KPI their performance every day, number of calls, what they've done, etc.
Okay. And in terms of restaurants coming into the network and being listed on Just Eat, how do you measure for the quality and how do you make sure those standards are kept?
Yeah, I think it's really important you understand some of it.
So one of the questions from Slido, from Nick Walden.
Yeah, it's a good question. So the way I think about quality is this, right? What's your quality and what's my quality is two different things. It's because every consumer is different, right? You might want the best local organic pizza and I just want the cheap one. And what's best for me, therefore, is the cheap one. And what's best for you is the organic one. So the way we think about quality on Just Eat is we want to present you with everything, all information. So we want to aggregate all the information for you as a marketplace and present it to you in a really smart, orderly way. And what does that mean? Mm-hmm. It means that we have an algorithm in our homepage. And if you go to Just Eat Now and search, you'll see the restaurant presented to you are by the consumer reviews in that neighborhood. So I like to think of Just Eat as, when I move into my house that I moved into, my neighbor told me what he said was the best local curry house. I like to think that Just Eat does that for you every day. Mm-hmm. Just Eat is your neighbor telling you this is the best local Indian restaurant in this neighborhood, because what we have in our organic listing is a pure listing from top to bottom of the restaurants by the consumers that have to have ordered at that restaurant. Because
okay.
To review on Just Eat, you have to have ordered at that restaurant. Mm-hmm. So that's why I like to think about it.
And is this a bad review? Do you remove those restaurants?
Nope.
Or
just if they have bad reviews.
Yeah.
So all that happens if they have bad reviews, they go down the listings. So as long as they have an operational license to operate, they'll be on Just Eat. We only kick them off, of course, if there's a food hygiene problem, then they'll go out, of course,
yeah.
Then we have to boot them off. But in terms of the rating system, what we'll do is we'll use the rating system. If you're the lowest rated, you'll be at the bottom, quite simply, which means you get the least amount of orders. But what we don't do, and I really passionately believe in this, go back to my origins as a restaurant sort of partner in the early days, is we don't just kick you at the bottom and leave you there to rot. Every 3 months, you'll get a phone call off one of our tele account managers saying, hey, listen, you're the 72nd restaurant out of 72. That's probably not making you feel good, right? And the reason why we can see is consumers are telling us you deliver late, your food quality is below standard, you need to do something about that. And if you get, by the way, if you get from 72 to 60, your revenue will grow from £100 a week on Just Eat to £400 a week. So we try to give them a little bit of the information around we're using the stick, but then also the carrot of improve your performance. So I hope over time what Just Eat will actually do in all our markets is drive standards throughout the industry.
Yeah. But ultimately, it's up to the customer to decide
Absolutely.
What's good, what's bad.
It's not our job to do that.
Okay.
We'll present you the data in an orderly way in a completely transparent fashion, but it's not our job to tell you what you think is good.
It's very democratic, yeah. In terms of a bit of a future, so what do you think is the industry's future big challenge?
I think there's two things going to happen for the industry. So from the consumer side, it'll continue to change and change quickly. I mean, in the 10 years, I've been in the industry, I've seen, you know, new cuisine categories. I mean, 10 years ago, sushi didn't exist in London. It's now the fastest growing cuisine. So I think the big thing we'll say is consumer habits continue to evolve quickly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, food education, food standards are changing all the time. Next year, there's a big EU regulation where everything we eat has to be presented with what the ingredients are.
Mm-hmm.
So there's loads of information that's changing around the industry all the time, which is, I think, for the better, by the way. I think that's really good. And I hope, and our intention is Just Eat is to be at the forefront of that, helping to engage and give that consumer that information again in a good way. I think the big thing we'll see, though, is we'll see the cuisine changes continue to evolve as consumers we're getting absolutely more diversified in our choice and our selection. The world is becoming a global place from a food perspective. We're all eating loads of different food choices from all over the globe. So I think that'll be the big thing we see continue to evolve over the next sort of 5, 6, 7 years.
Wow. Okay. And the industry, do you think they can cope with it, like in terms of the competition, they are on board with these challenges?
I think if you look historically, right, go back to the mother of all invention statement, I think, you know, entrepreneurs are brilliant at change, right? Entrepreneurs are brilliant at change. I'll give you an example. The reason why sushi's grown so quickly is, this is actually a fact, it's because the Chinese industry has realized that actually when they used to cook fish, that cost them money, and they used to charge you £5 for it, then they can now not bother cooking it and charge you £10. That's actually true. So what's happening is, of course, those entrepreneurs that maybe used to have a Chinese restaurant are now opening sushi restaurants, and they're bloody good at operating restaurants. They're bloody good at buying and they're damn good at delivering the food to you. So all that's happened is the industry's evolving with the consumer habit, and it follows it pretty quickly, actually, because, of course, where they, what they ultimately do is following where the money's going. So, yes, I see that evolving and continue to evolve, but I'm confident the industry will move with it, has done for decades.
You sit in the industry quite closely, and how big of the industry is independent operators as opposed to big and small chains?
In the UK, it's unbelievably led by independents, right? So of the 34,000 delivery restaurants, if you took out Domino's, which is 630 outlets, if you took out Domino's, the next biggest chain has 100, and they're all in pizza. Mm-hmm. If you talk about Chinese, you talk about Indian, it's completely independent dominated. So local entrepreneurs running local businesses. So yeah, of the 34,000 delivery, 33,000 would be independents in the UK.
Okay. Before we go to the audience and ask some Q&As from the audience, let's talk about one thing which I'd like to know. You've built this company in the UK from scratch. You were one of the founding guys. If you were to do it again, knowing what you know, apart from funding, doing it faster, yeah, how would you do it differently this time?
I'd build a better product earlier. I think we could have done a much better job with that much earlier. I think we could have got ahead of the curve on mobile quicker than we did. We sort of got a little bit navel-gazy about the fact we were growing, acquiring restaurants, and not thinking, well, yeah, but in 3 years' time, everyone was going to be mobile. So I think I would have got to that quicker. So we'd have been more product-focused, I think, a lot in origin. I think that would have helped to stimulate user adoption earlier as well. So I think, go back to my point about funding would have got us 18 months further down the road from where we are now, if we'd have done that round, Series A round earlier. Yeah. If we'd have been more product-led, we might have been 3 years further down the road from where we are now, if we'd have got ahead of the curve on that. So I'd definitely spent more time refining the product earlier. Not too much time, because to some extent it was land grab. So what you don't want to do is spend 2 years making the most beautiful product in the industry and look up and someone else has taken the entire market off you. It's just too late, consumers have gone. So, but I think we'd have spent a bit more time on the product.
And on the mobile side, you didn't have any indicators of people migrating to mobile and having smartphones?
Yeah, we did, but I'll tell you what we did. Like in any business, there's an opportunity cost, right? You have to forgo something. And at the time, we were in a big international expansion mode. So at the time, we'd gone from being in two markets to 13 in like 18 months. Mm-hmm. So of course, we had to build, by definition, 11 brand new platforms and build all the local products required to localize them. Because, for example, in Canada, you have local taxation laws. Yeah. In Brazil, you have to plug straight into the Inland Revenue Office. There's loads of stuff you have to do when you localize.
So you're busy expanding as opposed
to... So busy expanding as opposed to busy innovating the product.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There's some questions from the audience now. We have some microphones here, so do we have any mics here? If you don't, let's just stand up, and if you just speak up, so we can hear you.
Hi, my name is Nick. I'm from Body Kitchen. What criteria do you use to analyze the user of your app, i.e. who's buying these takeaways?
So we use several tools, but the big data analytics we're looking at, of course, is we know some great things about you. We know where you live, we know your email, and we know your payment information, and we know your mobile, and we also know where you eat. So we have some really useful data in order to what we can talk to you about. So that's why I said what I don't want us to ever become is when those companies just push horrible, spammy information at you as a customer of Just Eat. What I'd like to do is talk to you in a way that's really relevant and local to you. Because if you only ever buy curry, there's no good me telling you there's a new sushi restaurant opening down the road. You don't eat sushi, you eat curry. So I think what we can do is really localize, and I like less intrusive the better. So you think we'll use that data, for example, within the mobile app to send you a push notification, like push this button and your order will be done, save you the convenience of having to bother going the product. So we can see that. We can also see locally, if the website, of course, is not converting, we perhaps don't have the best food coverage in that area. Because go back to my point, if we've got the best local Chinese, the best local Indian, we haven't got the best local pizza, guess what? You might buy your Indian and Chinese on Just Eat, but you won't buy your pizza because you have to use the phone to that because we don't have the local pizza outlet. So we're using data on two dimensions. One, hopefully to talk to you in a relevant way as a customer of Just Eat. And two, hopefully to make sure that Just Eat becomes more and more relevant to you by making sure that our coverage is comprehensive of everything you're looking for in the market.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One more question there. Just stand up and speak up.
Hi, Kate. Hiya. I'm interested in what your main marketing channel is now, because I believe you say it's quite a majority of EPC. And if it is, I was wondering how you might deal with the Google testing premium
Yeah, you've got to get off the crack of PPC, right, as a business. It's really bad for you. So fortunately for Just Eat, we're not reliant on PPC. That was in the early days, back in 2006. 90% of the orders that come to Just Eat come from free sources. So that's either you come in direct to Just Eat, direct to the app, or direct via organic to the product. So more than 90% of orders now come from direct sources of traffic, if you like. So we're not reliant on anyone for consumers to find us. They come to us. So less than 10% now require us some sort of paid search, whether that's Facebook advertising, which is growing very quickly for us, as well as Google PPC. But of course, the other reason why we may have seen us do television ads is actually it stimulates that direct to Just Eat thing, because you don't go looking for a brand you know and is just sat on your phone. So the reason why television branding is actually our biggest source of advertising spend there. So TV spend is the biggest source of Just Eat investment. So, and that makes sense from a, as I just told you, 90% of the traffic then comes direct, and that's helped stimulate that more than any other thing.
And what's the conscious decision to go TV over YouTube or anything?
So, that's a good point. When I say TV, I mean probably all content. So TV and then, yeah, YouTube roll ads are becoming bigger. Netflix is becoming, yeah, so there's lots of stuff around that.
Do you have any learnings in terms of what works, what doesn't on TV?
Yes, again, we made some terrible mistakes. So we once put a TV ad out at 10:30 in the morning. I know, I told you we weren't that smart. So that was not very clever. The big learning for us was, you know, actually consumers make their mind up very very late. Before, you won't think that, oh, you know, your decision to order a takeaway is not a decision you made last Friday.
You know, they're hungry and they order.
They're hungry, they order, right? So we advertise between 5 p.m. and 7:30 p.m. Mm-hmm. and then between 10:30 p.m. and 11:30 p.m. So there's a good reason for that. And we can see the other big thing we learned from TV advertising is it's all about frequency of ad. So it's no good having what we did, the X Factor final ad a year ago, which is a brilliant vanity project, but a complete waste of time. Mm-hmm. Because, of course, it lasts for the day, no one bothers to even remember it. So the big thing we learned about television was it's all about frequency, so which is why we like to have our ads over and over again. We sponsor weekends on Dave, for example, so you see the Just Eat message over and over and over again. It's all about that.
Anything in terms of conversion, call to action, which works, what doesn't, some tips?
Yeah, I think the big thing that we've done, which was, I think at the time it was regarded as quite brave, we never did the Me Too first internet TV company ad. Yeah. I.e., here's our website and this is how you use it. We always hated those ads. We thought we'll always be a little bit more bold than that. So in our first TV ads, it was always about creating an emotional connection to the brand. So we had Belly and Brain was our first TV campaign, which is two little cartoon characters. And then more recently we had the chefs, so we're blowing up ovens and doing all sorts of crazy stuff. And we've never tried to do that sort of Me Too TV advertising, I'm an internet company, so use the website. We've always tried to just talk about more of the emotion of the occasion. So the big thing for us, the benefit we see that we got out of that, is our consumers have become incredibly loyal to the brand. And on social media, guess what? People don't talk about an ad that they see that shows them how to use a website. They definitely talk about an ad if you blow up an oven. So there's things you can do to help, which of course stretches the TV ad a bit further.
Okay, this question over there. Yes, you.
I wanted to ask you.
Can you just stand up and speak up?
What's your opinion on when it's a good time to move internationally? Because we're a young startup making some progress, but if we've got a long way to go in the domestic market. It's interesting hearing you say that you wish you raised the Series A a lot earlier. And what sort of challenges do you face when you move to a new country?
I think the big thing for us is I would not move internationally until you've proven the concept in one market, right? You've got to get that proof of concept done. And proof of concept beyond, oh, it works, actually that it's scaling a bit. And scaling a bit is a loose term, obviously, but you can really feel that within any given market, you've got the secret sauce of how to build the business, right? Because Just Eat doesn't have patterns around the technology, but I tell you something, we have patterns around how to do this business model, right? We know this business intimately, back to front, left to right, inside out. We know how to do this over and over and over again. And that takes a long time to learn, right? So if once you have that you know yourself, we know how to do this, we're getting real scale in this market, and we think there's other markets around the world crying out for this product, that's when you move. But I don't think you just do it because you think there's other markets and you've got a good business idea. You've got to get some proper traction and scale probably enough that you're at a Series A round and then internationalize.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there's one question here on Slido. Giving your Just Eat expand rapidly outside of growth, what else is on your product roadmap?
Okay, so other than the tracking thing we spoke about, we're pushing into restaurant hardware and software devices. So we have a tablet-based solution when our restaurants will process every order, not just their Just Eat orders. We actually will be the mechanism for them to manage every order that they place. And given it, bear in mind that in Denmark we'll be more than 50% of a lot of restaurants' revenues, why should that not be our device? And we're helping them to, there's lots of good things we can build into that.
Like a hardware device you give them?
Yeah, it's a tablet-based solution and it enables them to manage every order through it. I think that puts Just Eat again back at the heart of the restaurant experience. Is it what?
Is this your core business?
No, it's part of the product roadmap, which enables tracking for the consumer.
Okay.
That part of that device will enable us to connect all the delivery drivers up, and I think that's quite an interesting piece to get into. I think the other thing on the consumer side for us will be just continuation of the innovation around the mobile experience. I think there's so much more we can do on the mobile product, especially our app. Think about that. In tracking is one. Another one will be the search mechanism that you can search for favorites, etc. Because consumers are incredibly loyal, so there's a ton of great stuff we can do around that.
Okay, there's two more questions over here.
Yeah. Hendrik Swart from Distribution Development. You were saying that you would have liked to spend some more time on product development in the early days. Why didn't you do that? Was that because lack of resources, or did you ever use any external development partners, or do you have any recommendation for startups looking to get their thing going faster?
Yeah, I think the thing for us is there's a lot of back-end systems around Just Eat. So the front end appears incredibly simple, right? But if you think about Just Eat as a concept, actually we're as close to real-time e-commerce as it gets. You place an order and you expect it to be delivered in 45 minutes, right? Well, even Amazon has 24 hours. So we got 45 minutes from when you say go. So all our back-end systems that we built, and they were built in-house, they were our systems, actually work in real time. So when you place an order on Just Eat, that order goes in 1.6 seconds to the restaurant's kitchen, where there's a piece of hardware that then prints out the order. The restaurant then accepts that order by pushing one button, and then you get a message back in 1.6 seconds saying the order's accepted. So you think all that happens instantly, in real time, in relative terms to human life, right? And those back-end systems that the guys spent time building in the early days, while they didn't create a great, sexy front-end consumer product, my God, they created a brilliant back-end scalable system that now is able to process literally millions of orders a month in the UK, which require no manual intervention whatsoever. We can just send the order, two-way communication, done. Otherwise, you can end up with some of our competitors, including the German guys, they used to send their orders to fax machines. And guess what? Phone calls, experience, terrible. The one thing that I would have spent more time on, I thought I'd probably be really specific around, is reviews. We did a really lousy job with reviews, and that's one thing that, like, sort of legacy product work we're having to do. There's a ton of, I think, exciting stuff we can do around reviews. So I think that's the big product innovation we would have done better, I think, looking back on it. But the back-end system piece we nailed, just didn't focus enough on the front end.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. One more question. There you go.
My name is Robbie from Possibility. So there's a huge industry shift at the moment towards MPARs, and you touched on tablets earlier on. Besides building your own kind of tablet-based platform, what do you see, or what innovation are you guys going to be doing that's going to kind of plug into this industry change?
Yeah, I think the big thing that we'll do is connect all the consumer data up, right, that no one else can do. Because at the end of the day, right, lots of people can go and buy a tablet and put some software on it, enable you to do whatever, some kind of POS system. But what they won't have is, for example, in the UK, millions and millions of active user information, going back to the data we had, that we can help a restaurant be much smarter about how they run that business. Because when it goes into our system, it'll have all that data for the restaurant. And they'll be able to direct marketing campaigns through it and all that stuff to consumers that we know are in the market for hungry information. So if you think about the power of that as a brand, coupled to the B2B side innovation and technology and hardware, coupled to the fact that we are becoming, in certain markets, the consumer destination for takeaway, you connect those two things up, I think that's incredibly exciting what we can do with that data. And then add into that, we actually can help to manage and control the logistical network better. So three parts of the industry, consumers and restaurants, and then the logistical element. But if Just Eat is the heartbeat of all that, and managing all that to create a better experience for all those three different parts, I think you become a pretty exciting technology company. I mean, a lot of work to do, but I think that's pretty exciting.
So are you saying that you're going to give the power to restaurants to advertise back to your user base? So if you know...
Absolutely. 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 Because in the end, right, in the end, we're their partners and they're their customers. So absolutely. We're not in the business of not doing that.
So the last one is for me. Is Just Eat reminding David on Tuesday evening to order delivery?
Yes.
It is.
Yeah. So we only if you sign up to the mail campaign that you've got, you'll only get the mail. You'll notice it pretty quickly. So if you sign up to it, you'll see that you only get notified on the day that you order on.
Uh-huh.
We'll never talk to you on the days you don't. We used to send all our emails on a Friday because weekends were busiest, and we thought that was clever. But then we realised actually, if you order on a Monday or a Tuesday,
smart.
You never ordered on a Friday again.
That's really smart. Please give it up for David Buttress.
Thank you.
So this is it. Now it's time to network. Before we finish and go next door to have some drinks and meet some people, the next event is going to happen on the 18th of March. And this is going to be the first one we've ever done. What we did is we talked to Guy Kawasaki, which you might probably know. And we're going to be hosting an event, an interview with him, live from Silicon Valley, from the HQ of Google, where the Startup Grind CEO is going to interview him. And what we'll do is we have a venue like this, and we'll watch it live on the big screen. You can still ask questions. You can still sub in the questions and vote for them. So it's going to be the first one. We expect something around 10,000 attendees for this event. And we'll be sorting out the details for the event. It's going to be on 18th of March. Please feel free to go on the website and look for the details. In the meantime, let's do some networking. Let's meet some people. And thank you for coming.
My pleasure. Yes. Let me introduce you after we unplug you. A few people, if you have a few minutes.
Yes, yeah, sure, absolutely.
So I want to introduce Kimberly.
Just going from India.
Kimberly.
Lovely to meet you.
Great